You've been hearing a lot about RAG these days, but did you know that vector support in Azure SQL Database can make it easier for you to do that? Learn all about it and a very interesting code sample you might want to take advantage of this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Marco. Marco, thanks so much for joining us today. Can you kick us off by telling us a little bit about what you do?
Hello, and thank you for inviting me here. I'm Marco Minerva. I'm from Taggia, a wonderful town in Italy. And I am a freelance consultant, and I mainly work as a backend developer with .NET and Azure. I'm also a speaker at technical conferences, and I make regularly live streaming about coding on YouTube and Twitch.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we'll be sure to put a link in the description for folks who want to learn more about some of your streaming and other resources that they're probably going to be interested in, especially after watching this video, because we're going to be talking about RAG and vector search in Azure SQL Database. So I guess to kick it off, like when we think about RAG applications, like where is vector support in Azure SQL Database like come into it? And can you tell us a little bit about the problems and the solutions that we have today?
Yes, I think that vector support in a SQL database is a very killer feature because we know that we already have a solution, the so-called vector databases like Quadrant that help us with implementing a RAG solution. But it's also true that today, we have a huge number of applications that already use relational databases like SQL Server, of course, for example. And often, we don't want or we can't install another database. We need to see that we can already do RAG with SQL Server using a solution based on column store index. But the problem is that in this case, we need to have a table with a row for each single vector values. And the problem is that an embedding can contain more than 1,500 values. In this case, in some cases, we can have more than 3,000 values. So this kind of table can grow exponentially, and we all can guess the issue with this approach. On the other hand, with vector support, SQL databases store vectors in a very optimized binary format and provide a way to easily work with them. So it's a very, very interesting solution. And this is the reason why I have made some experiments, try to understand if we could use vectors as the foundation to build a RAG solution using .NET and the Semantic Kernel to verify if we can use FIC effectively in our applications, and in particular, what effort it requires to implement.
Awesome.
But I think it's better to see a demo to verify how the system works.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Okay. So I told you that I am a backend developer, so this is my typical UI, the Swagger UI. But I think that in this case, it is enough to verify all the stuff. Suppose that we want to create a RAG solution based on our documents. In this case, if I try to upload a document, first of all, the document is split in chunk, let's say in partition, to have a small piece of text to work with. Then I calculate the embedding for each of this partition using Semantic Kernel, and then I store the result in a SQL database as vectors, as said before. So if we take a quick look at the structure of the database, we just have two tables, a documents table and the most important one, the document chunks table, that for each partition contains the actual embeddings. In particular, we see the embedding column that is a var binary and is the column that will contain the values of our embeddings. So let's switch again to the Swagger and let's try import a couple of documents. For the sake of simplicity, we just use some PDFs from Wikipedia, so everyone can verify the result. In particular, I'm trying with the PDF about the planet Mars. Now the embedding are calculated. Let's wait a couple of seconds. And let's hope if everything works as expected. Okay, the first document has been loaded, and then just try to add another one about the moon.
And while you're loading these, Marco, a quick question. So basically, for folks who can't see the PDF, right? Like, this is literally just a print screen of the Wikipedia page that talks all about the moon and Mars. Got it.
Yes. I load this document in the to have this result. If we open this table, for example, if we try to make a select on document chunks, we see that now for each document, we have each for each chunk, we see this content table, and this embedding is the binary representation of the vector that has been calculated by Semantic Kernel, as said before. And now, if we try to modify this query using this function, vector to JSON array, that is a native function that is provided by vector support, now we can see that the actual values of the vectors are here. So for each piece of document, we have the numerical representation of its embedding. And it is the core of all the works about vector. Now, let's say to add another quick document about Pluto to make the things a bit more complex, but now I think that everything is straightforward. Okay, and now let's try to ask a question to the system. For example, I can ask, why is Mars called the red planet? Let's see if everything works as expected. And now I think we had the right answer. Okay, so everything works as expected. In this case, what happened? When I ask the question, first of all, I calculate the embedding of the question itself, and then I make this kind of query on the database, in particular using another native function provided by SQL database, that is vector distance. Vector distance, in particular, cosine distance between the embedding stored in the database, as we said before, and the array of the embedding that we have just calculated. The distance is such that the closer it is to zero, the more similar the embeddings are. So we get the first, in this case, in this demo, I get the first five chunk with the distance closer to zero, and then I use the content to augment the prompt that I pass to Semantic Kernel to perform a chat completion and to ask the question. So the context is used to enrich the knowledge of the model, and then this is the reason why when I ask this question, I get the answer from the documents I have just uploaded on the system. Yeah, very, very interesting, because this approach is really straightforward to implement. So let's take a quick look to the code to see what we need. Essentially, we need this NuGet package, because I'm using Entity Framework to work at very high level to with vector search. And then I use, of course, Semantic Kernel. And then all I need is to specify, when I declare the DB context, that I want to use vector search. Then in the definition of the document chunk, I declare a column of type float array. In the database are saved as var binary, I declare as float array, because I just need to say the configuration that this column contains a vector, and then all the conversion to and from the binary format is automatically made, so it makes the work with this solution very, very easy. When I upload the document, I just need to calculate the embedding of each paragraph, in this case using Semantic Kernel. Then I save the document and I use the classic float array that is converting as said. And finally, when I make the request, this query is the one that is translated in this way by Entity Framework using vector distance that is the core, as said, of all the system. So I get the more relevant chunk, in this case, the first five. I use them to augmented the prompt and then get the answer. So it's very, very easy. And in a bunch of line of code, I have a system that is able to answer to my question based on the documents I have provided to the database, as said, as we say before. And that is that
awesome.
Easy.
Wow. Yeah, no, super simple. Once you figure everything out, which it seems like maybe a little work there, but once you figure it out, it seems like it's super simple. And it seems like SQL database has the right support and makes this a little bit more performant, I'm guessing. Question I have for you for folks getting started, is this sample that you're sharing, this Swagger sample or .NET sample, something that is available on GitHub?
Yeah, it's available. I can share the address. Okay, it's on my GitHub repo, available here at this address.
Awesome, cool. We'll make sure to put this in the description for folks to learn more. Final question for you, Marco. Any tips or tricks for people who are just getting started with RAG and Vector?
Yeah, we have just seen how easy it is to work to get started with RAG and SQL Server thanks to Vector support. There are a lot of documentation example about RAG on the internet using Semantic Kernel and other project and other demo by Microsoft, like kernel memory, for example. The idea is to improve, to enrich the knowledge of a model by providing the information we need, as we have said. And now it's we have easy tools to use to implement this solution. And now it's up to us to understand how we can benefit from this new feature, like vector support, and to understand how we can enrich and create a compelling application based on it, of course.
Cool. Awesome. Well, folks, you heard it here first. Marco, thanks so much for coming on the show. I learned a lot. I'm sure our viewers have learned a lot. To our viewers, check the links in the description to learn more about the things Marco was working on, as well as a link to this code sample. If you like this episode, go ahead and give it a like, leave us a comment, let us know what you plan to use RAG for, especially this new vector support in Azure SQL database. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.